good evening, and thanks for joining this international webinar on the international campaign to get CAF off the Israeli apartheid train. We have an amazing lineup of speakers this evening, introducing from Al-Quds, Jerusalem, Fayrouz Sharqawi, advocacy coordinator of Grassroots Al-Quds. Thanks for joining us, Fayrouz. We have Trina Lise Sundnes, who's head of the International Department at the Norwegian Confederation of Trade Unions. Welcome, Trina. We have a Carlo Mazzoleni joining us from Italy, from the European Legal Support Center. Very kind of you to be with us this evening, Carlo. And we also have Louise Regan from who is the vice chair of the Palestine Solidarity Campaign in the UK. Thanks very much for joining us, Louise. Before our distinguished panel speak, I'm just going to give a short introduction, a bit of explanation about the company itself, and how the company got involved with the Jerusalem light rail contract, and also a little bit about how the campaign here in the Basque Country got started. CAF is a bus and train manufacturer with quite a long history, with very strong roots in the Basque Country, particularly in the province of Gipuzkoa, where its headquarters is situated. The workforce in the main Beasain plant and the local community in that area have always had very strong connections and loyalty towards the company. And the company also has very strong connections with the Basque Nationalist Party, the PNV, which is the governing party in the Basque Autonomous Region. And also the Basque Autonomous Government is actually a shareholder in the company. It has a 1% stake in the shareholding. And the major shareholders are BBK and Kucha, which are local ex-publicly owned banks, which also have very strong connections to the Basque Nationalist Party. CAF in recent years has been enjoying a great deal of commercial success. It's been growing its business very strongly. Its business has become internationalized much more in the last few years. It currently enjoys a record order book. In fact, it enjoyed a record order book before it got involved with the contract in Jerusalem. And so, when it participated in the tender and before it won the contract, it was in an exceptionally strong economic position. It won the contract in August 2019, and the contract is to build and to extend the existing red line of the Jerusalem light rail and to build and operate a new green line. As is now notorious, a number of other multinational companies were initially involved in the tender, but nearly all the rest of the companies, names like Siemens, Bombardier, Alstom, Systra, all pulled out of the contract, and some of them specifically cited their concerns about the violation of international law when pulling out of the contract. The JLR system itself is designed to connect a string of illegal Israeli settlements in East Jerusalem and in the surrounding area of the West Bank. And the objective of the whole project is, along with the whole network of settler roads, with the apartheid wall, with the demolition of Palestinian homes, is to create, as a concrete fact on the ground, the annexation of East Jerusalem, and to push out the Palestinian population. CAF was very well aware of all these details when it got involved with the tender and before it actually won and accepted the contract, not least because its own workforce in the form of the Works Council actually published a letter to the board of the company asking them to withdraw from the contract, something which they ignored. And CAF not only went ahead knowingly with this contract, but actually did so in partnership with an Israeli construction company called Shapir, which is one of the companies on the United Nations Human Rights Council's database of companies complicit in the illegal settlement building enterprise. Work started here on the campaign on coordinating, creating and coordinating an international, first of all, a national and then an international campaign at the G7 protest in Endaya in August 2019. And the campaign was officially launched here in the Basque Country in February 2020. And since then, the campaign has really gone from strength to strength. It's coordinated again across all the provinces of the Southern Basque Country. And we have, since the campaign was launched, reached out to trade unions, to political parties. We've held mass email and telephone campaigns. We've organized nationwide simultaneous demonstrations, despite the restrictions imposed by the COVID-19 legislation. And we've promoted debates in both the Basque Autonomous and the Navarran parliaments. And simultaneously, the BNC, the Boycott National Committee, has been active in bringing trade unions and other groups from Europe and other parts of the world into the campaign. And so in the upcoming conversation with our invited guests, we hope to, first of all, explore the effects that the JLR is having on the population of East Jerusalem and what's being done to internationalize the campaign to get CAF off the apartheid train. Before we hear from our speakers, I'd just like to mention that you'll be able to ask questions via the chat, to make comments, and please do so, and we look forward to responding to all these before we finish the webinar. So, Fayrouz, if we could turn to you first, could you tell us a bit about how the Jerusalem Light Rail project fits into Israel's wider plans to annex East Jerusalem and the impact that it's having on the local community?
Yes, thank you, Richard. Hello, everyone. Hello, greetings from Jerusalem. I'm happy to be here and to speak about this project and what it means to us, the Palestinians living in Jerusalem. And I would like to build on your introduction, Richard, and say, and maybe remind everyone about the context that we are speaking about here. We are talking about the Israeli occupation's goals for Jerusalem, which are to annex as much land from Jerusalem as possible with as little Palestinian presence on it as possible. And since 1967, since the occupation of the eastern part of Jerusalem, the Israeli policies have been focusing on the annexation of the land and the displacement of the people, putting for themselves the goal to achieve what they termed a so-called demographic balance between Jews and non-Jews, an imbalance that stands at 70% Jewish, 30% non-Jewish, in other words, 70% Israeli and 30% Palestinian, policies have been following that goal, building up towards that goal and displacing Palestinians systematically, strategically from Jerusalem. These policies include, for example, the revocation of the Palestinian legal status. Palestinians in Jerusalem are considered immigrants to Jerusalem by the Israeli occupation authorities. Their permits to live in their own hometown are being revoked, taken away, and with them, the right of these Palestinians to live in their own city. Another tool is urban planning, and that is the title of our conversation today. Urban planning policies in Jerusalem include the confiscation of Palestinian privately owned land for the building and expansion of settlements, colonies in and around our communities, home demolition, the demolition of Palestinian homes, usually at the pretense that they are built illegally, while we know and should emphasize that it is the Israeli occupation authorities that prevent building permits systematically from Palestinians, then using this as an excuse to demolish their homes, uproot them from Jerusalem. Other policies include policing and mass incarceration of Palestinians. And so these policies are the reality that we live and face in Jerusalem, and the light rail fits into this picture. When speaking about the annexation of Jerusalem, then we also speak about colonies that are built outside of the Palestinian neighborhoods and villages of the eastern part of Jerusalem, oftentimes on their lands. These colonies, first of all, prevent our communities from naturally growing, and then they also create Israeli control over the land and are a step towards the annexation, the actual de facto annexation of these lands. Of course, the other side of the coin is usually the displacement, the uprooting, and the dispossession of Palestinians, because oftentimes we are speaking about the confiscation of Palestinian lands, privately owned lands that we desperately need to build homes, that we desperately need for our communities to naturally grow. Connecting colonies to the city center, collecting colonies around the eastern part to the western part of occupied Jerusalem is a very important and clear goal that the Israeli occupation authorities have. Before even we saw the first tram in Jerusalem, there has existed a huge network of roads, colonial roads that connect these colonies to the city center. On these roads, Israeli bus lines have been running for decades, connecting colonies in the West Bank to 48 occupied lands, and in our case, also to the center of Jerusalem, acting as an incentive to the settlers to live in settlements, to live in colonies where the housing is subsidized, the taxation is subsidized, and also there is a very efficient public transport network that allows people to make it very quickly and very efficiently to and back from work every day. And into this picture comes the Jerusalem Light Rail, the first line that already has been running for many years now, runs between and connects the colony of Pisgat Ze'ev in the north to the city center. Pisgat Ze'ev, by the way, is one of the biggest colonies in the eastern part of Jerusalem, and it is home to more than 40,000 settlers. And now we have new lines planned and under construction. Now, please keep in mind that these lines and these networks of public transport and roads, they need land to be built on. And usually the Israeli strategy is to intentionally take land from the Palestinians in order to build these roads and these tram lines. So the dispossession of Palestinians is not a byproduct. It is one of the goals when thinking about projects that, let's all remember, are marketed by Israel as the development of the city. I mean, it's marketed as urbanization, marketed as the development properly of a city for all its residents, while if we look at the Zionist colonial projects in Jerusalem, we see that they usually, not only that they don't serve the Palestinian communities, but they also usually come at our expense. lands are confiscated, homes are demolished because they stand in the way of the planned roads and infrastructure. And so usually it is dispossession of Palestinians, but also keep in mind fragmentation of our communities. Divide and conquer is a very important policy that is used. The fragmentation of our communities is used against our presence in the city. And so by building colonies and roads that separate us and sever us from each other, the Israeli occupation authorities gain a political goal in addition to the annexation of the land. Now, speaking about the new line, you know, a year ago, the first lockdown was imposed here in Jerusalem. And during the lockdown, almost all market sectors were shut down by the occupation authorities, except for the necessary crucial sectors like the health services sector, for example. One of these sectors that was considered crucial and urgent by the Israeli occupation authorities was the construction sector. And that is not surprising, even though it should be surprising hearing about this sector deemed essential that cannot stop during a pandemic. Well, in this case, it is so essential because Israel is a colonizer that has its top priority as continuing with its non-stop, with its colonial projects, expansion. So even the pandemic was used by the Israeli occupation in order to accelerate the work on the Jerusalem light rail. So taking advantage of the fact that there were less cars in the streets, less people in the streets, and then we witnessed how the work on the tram lines has accelerated in the last year. You see it everywhere around the old city where I go to work, in Shu'afat where I live. You see it on the road in between. A lot of work is happening at the same time. Now, I'll use the last 2 minutes I have in order to maybe just mention what we at Grassroots Al-Quds believe should be done about this. You know, the bottom line is the Israeli occupation state is a war criminal. It violates rights and it commits war crimes. And it is enabled and funded by, first of all, governments around the world, governments that send aid to Israel and also governments that deal with Israel. But also it is enabled by the corporations, in this case, CAF involvement in the Jerusalem light rail. It enables the Israeli colonization of Palestinian lands and violation of Palestinian rights by normalizing Israel, treating Israel as a normal state that you can do regular business with without any moral questions. And I would like to emphasize the fact that we Palestinians and Palestine solidarity activists and movements should not be terrorized into the corner where we have to prove every little detail and every little case and make a case, and especially a legal case, for each atrocity that this colonial regime commits in Palestine. I think that we should always start with the fact that even if the Jerusalem light rail itself was not being built on 67 occupied lands, simply dealing with Israel as a normal country is problematic. It is problematic to enable Israel, to fund Israel. It is even more problematic when knowing that this specific project is violating Palestinian rights, is displacing Palestinians from Jerusalem and dispossessing Palestinians in Jerusalem. So I think that it is very important to emphasize over and over again the importance of boycott and divestment, because this is a reminder that we the people have the power to say no, not with our money and not in our name. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Fayrouz. Your mention of the legal issues brings me nicely onto our next guest, Carlo. Just before then, I'd like to remind Spanish speakers that they can actually choose a Spanish option on Zoom. Para la gente que quiere escuchar el webinar en castellano, se puede elegir la opción en castellano en Zoom, ¿vale? So, turning to you, Carlo, could you tell us what work the European Legal Support Centre has been doing in connection with the CAF campaign, and something about the legal tools that are available for the campaign to use?
Yeah, sure. First of all, hello everyone. A pleasure to be here. And so, first of all, the European Legal Support Center is an NGO based in Amsterdam, providing legal assistance to people and groups advocating for Palestinian rights in Europe. And since a year now, we have been developing a research concerning possible implications in the field of public procurement for companies operating in the illegal settlement enterprise in the OPT. So the main area, the main field of our research was public procurement. And we started this on suggesting in collaboration with Amnesty UK, which is very active on the issue. And for that, we developed arguments, which have then been used in civil society campaigns for demanding the exclusion of CAF from specific tenders procedures in the UK and in Spain, and more recently one in Catalonia as well. So, and of course, the demand to exclude CAF is based on the involvement we are dealing with of the company in economic activities resulting in serious violation of human rights and international humanitarian law. And so this is the factual basis that we pointed out to contracting authorities. And now we'll give you a very brief overview of the legal arguments that we found and developed for sustaining the lawfulness of such exclusion. And so the main legal basis on which we rely is the EU directive on public procurement, because the issue is regulated at a EU level. And this directive provides for a ground of exclusion for grave professional misconduct, which means that contracting authorities are allowed to exclude companies whose integrity is questionable due to grave professional misconduct. Now, this is a very open concept, and we as an ELC basically sustain a human rights-based interpretation of this ground of exclusion. So we argue that it would be lawful for competent authorities to interpret it as encompassing cases where companies are involved in grave breaches of international law, as the case of CAF, due to the involvement in the settlement enterprise. And for sustaining such interpretation, we refer to three sets of arguments, which are basically EU law, because indeed it provides the harmonized rules on the public procurement. And it has also to be noted that the EU directive containing this ground of exclusion has been implemented through national laws in different EU members, but still all the national laws incorporated this ground of exclusion, and at the same time, EU law remains a main source for the interpretation of national law as well. So we rely on EU law, and at the same time on international law instruments. First of all, the United Guiding Principle on Business Human Rights, and then binding obligation of international law. As regards to EU law, the two considerations which are important is that the concept of grave professional misconduct is very open. It has been interpreted broadly by the European Court of Justice, which stated that it's open to interpretation by public procurement procurers and on a case-by-case basis. So it really depends. And at the same time, EU law explicitly encourages procurers to take into account a variety of non-economic interest, because public procurement have been increasingly regarded as a policy tool for the achievement of a plurality of environmental and social conditions. So on the basis of this, we sustain that it would be lawful for procurers to interpret grave professional misconduct also in light of the United Guiding Principle of Business Human Rights, which are the most authoritative source in the field, and explicitly states that the responsibility to respect human rights is an expected standard of conduct for all businesses wherever they operate. And that for doing so, companies are expected to operate with a proper human rights due diligence, which means that they should have in place internal corporate mechanisms for addressing and possibly also anticipate a negative impact of the on human rights of their economic activities. And the UNGPs explicitly refers to public procurement, inviting states not to deal with companies which do not carry out proper human rights due diligence as a way to enforce the respect of such standards. And as regards the implementation, the UNGPs are a non-binding instrument and have been adopted by the UN Human Rights Council in 2011, but through the times they have been regarded as the most authoritative source. And many states have adopted national action plans. So officially committing to the enforcement and the respect of such standards. So we argue that grave professional misconduct or better, an economic operator integrity may be questionable due to the violation of standards set by the UNGPs. And finally, we argue also that this interpretation of grave professional misconduct would be consistent with binding obligations arising from international law. Because indeed, according to the duty of no recognition, which is a binding principle of international law on all states and also on all their public authorities, which include contracting authorities in the field of procurement, must avoid any kind of deal and deal with which may result in assistance of unlawful situation. And as regards Palestine, it has been clearly recognized as an unlawful situation from the International Court of Justice in 2004 and the UN Security Council as well in 2016. So there are no doubts that all states have a legal obligation and not just a mere political option or choice not to cooperate with Israel. And so also in light of these international principles, such interpretation of grave professional misconduct would be lawful and consistent then with single states' international obligation and commitment and commitments. And now the main challenge in preparing, in addressing the issue and in preparing this legal memo for contracting authorities is that is missing a clear guidance or interpretative notes from governments or competent authorities, clarifying that indeed this ground of exclusion could be interpreted in this way. So it is not expressly provided, but nevertheless, there are some exceptions. And as I said at the beginning, public procurement are used for the achievement of a plurality of objectives, social and environmental. So the same EU directive provides, for example, for grounds of exclusion related to other forms of human rights violations, such as forced labor, human trafficking, child labor, and so on. And so we argue that this approach towards public procurement as a means for the improvement of a variety of objectives and also for respect of some categories of human rights may be justified, so maybe render lawful an application, a human rights based application and interpretation of the ground of exclusion for grave professional misconduct. And a very important exception to this lack of guidance is given by a public procurement note, which was issued by the Scottish government in 2014, which expressly recognized the link between grave professional misconduct and violations of international law and human rights in particular. And so this note went even further as regards to our topic here, because it was stated that indeed the involvement in the settlement enterprise can amount to grave professional misconduct and can lead to the exclusion of a company therein involved. So the hope is that more and more of such interpretive guidance would be adopted, because this would definitely facilitated a possible exclusion of companies involved in Palestine. But at the same time, it is true that a human rights-based interpretation would be lawful, allowed under EU law, and consistent with home states' international commitments and obligations, most important. So, thank you.
Great, thanks to you, Carlo. So you mentioned there the case of Scotland, and also the fact that that your organisation had given specific advice to the UK campaign. If we can turn to you, Louise, how can these legal tools, do you think, be used in the specific case of the campaign against CAF's involvement in the apartheid train in the UK?
Hi, thanks, Richard. And it's very good to hear both of the other speakers. So my name's Louise Regan. I'm from the Palestine Solidarity Campaign, which is the biggest organisation in the UK campaigning for justice for Palestinians. And but I'm also a national officer of my union, and the trade unions have very good links with Palestine Solidarity Campaign in the UK, which is very useful, not only in terms of the work that we do, PSC, but in terms of getting those trade unionists engaged and supporting our actions. And you're right, the legal framework that Carlo's referred to has been used in the work we are doing with our members in the UK. So as you have said, CAF is involved in our high-speed HS2 network that is being built proposed to be built. And we have, obviously, when we became aware that they were bidding and of the massive concerns around their involvement in the Jerusalem light rail, then we obviously wanted to involve our members in campaigning against that. We have campaigned over many years against various companies and organisations that are involved in complicit work with Israel and the impact that has. Obviously, during these times of COVID, we're not out on the streets as we often would have been at other times, but that hasn't stopped us for sure. And we have set up a sort of an online petition sort of system for our members so that they can contact the minister who's responsible, urging them to exclude CAF. And we've done that around, and some of this has already been said, so apologies that I'm repeating some of the things, but basically what we always want to do is educate our membership about what is happening and why we're doing what we're doing, you know, so we're continuing to raise awareness, and our membership is growing, so we know we're having a positive impact. So we explain to them about the situation with CAF and their involvement in with another Israeli company in a further expansion of that Jerusalem light railway. And for people listening, I don't know how many people are listening who have been to Palestine or been to Jerusalem. I have been to Jerusalem many times, to East Jerusalem. In fact, I stay in, we take a delegation twice a year, and we go out and we look at the settlements and we see their expansion. And I always say to members when I'm talking to them, it sort of said, they sound quite small settlements. These are huge, expansive towns and cities in some cases, and they are growing. And every time I go, those settlements are expanding more. Every time I go, I see more land being taken away. And I have seen the expansion of the Jerusalem light rail on my visits. I've seen the amount of land that is being taken away already. And that is further, you know, the expansion of that will just take more and more land away. And I think Fayrouz was very clear in the impact that would have for the Palestinian population in East Jerusalem. And I think we have to remember, you know, that they will continue. It's not just about stopping when they've pushed Palestinians out of East Jerusalem. That, you know, there is an attempt to keep pushing and taking more and more of that land. So it's important that we continue to raise this amongst our members. I mean, our government has said very clearly that settlements are illegal. And, you know, they're very clear about that. They're illegal under international law, and that is the basis on which we are putting pressure on our government, along with the legal work that Carlo has referred to. So we are lobbying HS2 and the minister responsible to exclude CAF from the bidding to provide rolling stock for HS2, based on its role in the Jerusalem light rail. And it's been, as I said, supported by that legal brief signed by lawyers for Palestinian human rights and the European Legal Support Centre. And that's on the basis of grave professional misconduct. That's the term that they use over their role in operating the Jerusalem light rail and aiding Israel's colonization of Palestinian land. And I think we have done a huge amount of lobbying. Thousands of our supporters have written. And to date, the minister and HS2 have ignored those demands. We have done quite a lot of work around the list of companies that have been recognised as complicit in crimes or linked with the crimes of Israel. So we, it's not new, you know, this is something we are developing quite a lot. So we haven't, at the moment, today, despite our huge amount of lobbying, we haven't had a positive impact yet, but we are not ones to give up lightly here in Palestine Solidarity Campaign. So we are having a national day of action on March the 30th. Again, it will be an online day of action, so there'll be a lot of social media work, a lot of exposure about what is happening, and a lot of pressure being put upon our government to make sure that they, you know, do not award to CAF. I'll just, before I finish, just touch briefly on your question earlier to me, Richard, before we started, around trade unions and how we engage where we have, because we have a CAF factory in Wales, and what how that sometimes can cause dilemmas. And I think it is difficult for trade unions when they have workers employed in companies, because obviously, particularly at the moment here in the UK, and I would imagine globally, you know, with the pandemic, we are seeing mass job loss. And so workers are often very anxious about their situation. But what we are doing through Palestine Solidarity Campaign is going out. So our staff members are going out to, supported by our trade unions, who we have very good links with, they're setting up meetings to go and speak to workers in those companies, not just this company, but, you know, across the board companies where we've got concerns, so that those members are educated about what the issues are that we are raising. That it's not about us attacking them as workers, we're attacking the things that their company is doing and their complicity, and that we want them as employees to join with us to put pressure on their managers and the people running their companies to withdraw from the situations that, you know, where they are involved in complicity with Israel and the work that they are doing. So we will continue to do that. I don't know, so if somebody is going to ask this, I do not know if we have done any work with CAF employees, so but I certainly will be investigating that, because I thought it was a very good question that you asked me earlier on, Richard. But thank you very much, it's very good to be here.
Thanks very much to you, Louise. It's interesting that the impact of the pandemic in different places in Palestine is being used by the Israeli occupation authorities to speed up the construction of this infrastructure, this apartheid infrastructure. And in the UK, it's preventing people getting out on the streets and demonstrating. It's interesting the difference here, because we are still able to get out and demonstrate, although there are restrictions put on us, but it's not as draconian as it seems to be in the UK. Okay, so if I can now bring in Trina Lisa. Thanks for waiting so long, Trina. It's a great privilege to have this with you, and it'd be really interesting to hear about what's happening in Norway. A significant number of Norwegian trade union organizations, particularly rail unions, have joined the CAF campaign. Could you tell us a bit about how this came about? Is there a particular awareness in Norway about the Palestinian people's struggle to defend their rights in the face of Israeli colonization and apartheid? And also, obviously, tell us a bit about what's happening. What are these groups doing?
Yeah, well, thank you. Well, first of all, I'd like to thank you for the invitation to speak at this webinar on the challenges and strategies for CAF to stop their activity related to the illegal Israeli settlements. The Norwegian Confederation of Trade Unions, LO Norway, we're representing about 970,000 members, workers in 25 affiliated unions. I'm head of the international department at ELO, and we're about 15 dedicated employees at the department that works with international policy and regulations, various solidarity projects, some part financed through the Norwegian Foreign Aid Program, and some fully financed by the Confederation itself. At the time, we're involved in about 25 different projects with partners, all trade unions in several regions around the world. And to get into your question, Richard, ELO Norway has been committed to the fight for justice in Palestine since the 90s. For years, we had a development project with the Palestinian Confederation of Trade Unions, PGFTU. ELO's leadership visits Palestine regularly. So I've also seen the situation on ground, and as Louise also stated, it's quite an eye-opener what's happening. And then to get on to where we're at, in 2017, we decided at the Congress that ELO Norway should work for an international economic, cultural, and academic boycott of Israel. And in order to deliver on that, we try to influence our international umbrella organization, ITUC, to adopt an action program in line with our congressional resolution. Our proposal for a full boycott of Israel was not met with much enthusiasm, but the ITUC Congress decided that states and businesses should be dissuaded from directly or indirectly enabling or profiting from activities related to the illegal settlements. So the delegate at our Congress in 2017 wanted action. Unless there are consequences, nothing will change, as they say. And as a consequence, we updated our ethical guidelines to ensure that companies with ties to the Israeli occupation are avoided in procurement processes. And then when we learned that the Expedia Group was on the UN list of 112 companies involved in Israel's violation of international law, we also encouraged our unions who used Expedia subsidiary via Agencia to change their travel agents. And then last autumn, when we became aware of CAF's involvement in the Jerusalem light rail, we were alarmed. And as you said, our railway trade unions are very concerned about this. And also the company, CAF then, is in the process of gaining large market shares in public transport, among other things, through the delivery of trams to Sporveien in Oslo, a new train set to the Airport Express, which is the Airport Express, Flytoget, and in maintenance through the subsidiary Euromaint. And then in addition, the company has issued bids to secure a major delivery of trains to the state-owned company Norwegian Trains, or in Norwegian, Norske Tog. And we talk about a lot of money, and we talk about state-owned companies here. So since we consider the Jerusalem light rail a violation of international law, we urge the Norwegian companies not to award new contracts to CAF. We also ask the Central Bank of Norway to withdraw their investments in CAF and in their Israeli partner, Shapir Engineering and Industry Limited. And then, unfortunately, the response we have received so far has not been as forthcoming as we'd hoped for. Norwegian Trains, they stated that they would not reject CAF as a provider, partly because there is no final conviction, which we thought was rather odd. And then the head of the Norwegian OECD contact point, however, said in an interview that he believed that that is not enough to state that CAF has not been convicted of criminal offenses. In a letter, we asked the company, Norwegian Train, to consider rejecting CAF due to their involvement in the illegal settlements in East Jerusalem, and then also canceling the procurement process, since the competition regulation stipulates too narrow criteria. And then, according to the head of the Norwegian OECD contact point, Norwegian purchasers are required by law to have sustainable routines that ensures that their procurement schemes promote respect for fundamental human rights, where there is a risk of violations of these. And according to him, the question of sustainable routines is a legal question that the other providers can try in court. So if tried in court, the outcome can be dissuasive for the competition. So in addition then, CAF may be excluded from the competition if it can be documented that CAF has contributed to human rights violations in connection with its involvement with JLR, or that CAF has or was aware of or should have been aware of human rights violations related to the Jerusalem light rail. So there is a large amount of UN and independent documentation of violations of Palestinian rights that could be explored further to generate evidence of the impact of JLR on the rights of Palestinians. But to follow such a track, it might be very time consuming and very complicated. However, a quick search indicates that by creating infrastructures that enables de facto annexation of Palestinian land, the settlements, the JLR is a violation of Palestinians' life rights to self-determination, as projected by the UN Charter. And the constructions of the JLR, the red line, includes the expropriation of land in Palestinian neighborhoods. So also then the JLR is also part of a physical and administrative system, which ensures that the Palestinians are separate but not equal in Jerusalem. The construction and operating of the JLR participates in its discriminatory system, which results in violation of rights, such as the rights to equality and non-discrimination, freedom of movement, family, home, health, education, work, and adequate standard of living. So recently, a representative of the Norwegian Labour Party asked the Minister of Transportation a question in the parliament regarding the government's will to contribute to a Norwegian Train's publishing its due diligence in the CAF case. And even though that the minister's reply was vague, I am left with a feeling that Norwegian Trains at a later stage in the process might have to publish their due diligence review of CAF, which we think they should. And then also for a better understanding of the legal landscape we are operating in, Ella, together with the Norwegian People's Aids and the Norwegian Union of Municipal and General Employees, is starting a project to examine the gaps in Norwegian law and regulation regarding business activities in conflict areas. So we are now reaching out to various political parties to increase the pressure to prevent state-owned companies from entering into new contracts with CAF until they determine its engagement in war crimes and withdraw from the construction and operation of the Jerusalem light rail. Before I end, I'd also like to mention that Ella was a member of the Ethic Information Committee appointed by the Norwegian government to prepare a proposal for an act regulating enterprises' transparency about supply change, duty to know and due diligence. We do support the European Trade Union Confederation's push for an EU directive on mandatory corporate due diligence and the ITUC's work for a UN treaty on business and human rights. Lastly, it might be of interest to some of you to be aware that the guidelines for observation and exclusion of companies from the Norwegian government's pension global fund are reviewed. And some of the points that we as Confederation stressed in the consultation process to the committee proposals was that the threshold for starting an investigation and follow-up procedure of possible breaches of the guidelines must be relatively low. And also that the exclusion criteria related to occupation must be better followed up. And since the fund is among the world's largest sovereign wealth fund, it does set an example for other investors. So we think it's quite important that they actually have regulations that can keep them in line with human rights and so on. And also, we mentioned that it's time to consider the development of a new ethical index with a view of greater use of pre-filtering or positive screening of sectors and companies. So we hope that our points will be taken into consideration and that we will have a better and more practical used set of regulations. So we're awaiting that. But I'm looking forward to the discussion. So thank you so far.
Thanks to you, Trina, and thanks to everybody that all fascinating contributions. Just to remind viewers that you can send in your questions. There are 80 people watching this discussion at the moment, which is really good to know. So do keep your questions coming in. First question for Fayrouz. One of the comments that companies and institutions say to justify the JLR and CAF is that Palestinians can use the JLR, so it doesn't exclude them. Could you please tell us your views on this, and what arguments could you use to dispel this claim?
Yes, thank you. It reminds me of the claim by those factory owners in the West Bank, Israeli factory owners, factories which are built and active on 67 occupied land, active with the stolen water and human resources of the West Bank, that claim that, but hey, we offer Palestinians jobs. Let's all imagine this imaginary story. Someone lives in a home, someone else comes, takes this home by force, settles down in the home, enslaves the owner of the house, and suddenly decides to build an elevator between the first floor and the second floor. And then they would say, but hey, it's okay to build this elevator because my slave is gonna use it to go up and down between the two floors. This is exactly how this claim sounds to me. First of all, we are speaking about an occupier that according to international law, should not have any projects on stolen land. So let's begin with the fact that whether it serves Palestinians or not, this is a criminal light rail. Secondly, it's a criminal state that is building this rail for very political, colonial, clear colonial goals. And I think that by zooming into one tiny bit of imagined benefit for the Palestinians is very problematic. I think that we shouldn't even go into these details. I think that the right answer to this is we want to build our own Palestinian light rail and use it. We are not thankful and grateful for a colonial tram that stole our lands, demolished our homes, severed and fragmented our communities. And the only thing it claims it can do for us is take us around from one place to another. I think that what's important to emphasize here is that we should not be, and the person who asked this question should not be dragged into that place of looking at the tiny bits. I think there is a very clear cut here, and we should not be driven into mazes where we try to find good and bad and the complexity of the story. No, it's not a complex story. This is a clear story of land robbery and theft and the natural resources theft and robbery, and we should not cooperate with it. This is a criminal state, and these companies should not cooperate with it. And you can always find 1% or 0.1% goodness in evil. That doesn't make evil acceptable or normal or legitimate.
I understand anyway that the tram doesn't serve, it doesn't practically serve Palestinian communities very well anyway. If I can turn to you now, Carlo, it's not very common for public contracting authorities to exclude companies from public tenders. Do you think it would be possible for them to exclude CAF? And also, what impact would it have on this question if CAF were to be included in the United Nations database of companies which are complicit with the illegal settlement building enterprise?
Yeah. Okay, I would start from the second question, actually, regarding the UN database, because indeed all the work we started at DLC was also a way to find a concrete application for the database, which had been released just, the same period we started with this project. They are strictly related. And but in any case, for answering the question, the fact that CAF is not named doesn't really make a big difference, because being mentioned in the database definitely proves that a company is operating in the settlement enterprise and is therefore involved in facilitating and maintaining grave violations of international law. But nevertheless, if we have clear proofs and reliable findings concerning a company involvement in such a working environment, then the consequence should be the same. The fact that CAF is not named cannot be regarded as a reason for not considering it involved in such a violation. So I don't think that would be a very big difference. Unless, apart the case, which is not the case now, but if the UN database would in the future be regarded as a list of companies for which there are concrete consequences, maybe as well in the field of procurement, then yes, of course, being named would entail concrete consequences. But given that for the moment this is not the case, I think that in the field of procurement there would be no difference. Is just easier to demand for the exclusion of a company, to argue that a company is involved in grave violation if it is named, because then there are no doubts. But as I said, the opposite could still work. And as regards to the first question, this really depends about the countries we're looking at. because, for example, in Spain, as far as I know, as I'm aware, the ground of exclusion had never been applied in general. I mean, no company has ever been excluded from a procurement. So not only for grave professional misconduct, just in general. So we know and we are aware that it's very, very difficult to obtain a very first and historic exclusion of CAF. But nevertheless, this is a way to argue and to expose the issue to procurers and to show that it would be lawful if only these instruments which exist would be used and used in a certain way. This would be perfectly lawful. So, yeah, this is the idea.
Great, thanks, Carlo. Louise, could you tell us a little bit about the current context in the UK? I mean, the UK at the moment suffers under a far right government, and how's that affecting campaigns in solidarity with Palestine, specifically the CAF campaign? I mean, I know you've asked the government to consider this legal opinion with regard to the tendering of the HS2 contract. I mean, how does the nature of the UK government affect your hopes for whether there'll be a positive result from that?
I mean, it is difficult because we don't have a government that is very positive around these issues, that's for sure. But what we do have is an ever-increasing population who are aware of what is happening to the Palestinian people and who are raising their voices and speaking out about it. So, you know, our membership continues to grow. Our trade union recruitment continues to grow. Obviously, our trade union congress this year, despite it being an online congress, we passed a very strong motion in support of the Palestinian people for the first time using the term apartheid in a motion that's gone through that congress, and recognizing what is happening there. So we may have a government that's not doing what we need to do, but for sure people on the ground and the trade union movement are committed to doing that. I think whilst I suppose many of us won't feel hopeful that we'll necessarily get what we want, what we are doing is being very outspoken and making sure that other people are hearing about it. So whilst, you know, I always think with these campaigns, even if we don't win, if we gain another 200 people, in my city and the next city and the city down the road who understand what is happening to the Palestinian people, who sign up to support the Palestinian people, then, you know, we're forever building our groundswell of pressure on our government. And obviously we will continue to put pressure. And that it isn't to say that all politicians, even within the Conservative Party, do not support the Palestinians. There are, politicians throughout all of our political parties, actually, who understand what is happening and do support the rights of the Palestinian people and will support us. But we don't have, you know, those numbers are very small at the moment. So it's for us as individuals to put pressure on our own members of parliament and to try and change that situation, really. But as I say, from my point of view, you know, I've been active in this movement for a long time. And, you know, when I first became active fighting for Palestinian rights, it was a hard job. You know, it was, you know, you got a lot and lot of people pushing back against you who didn't, you know, weren't on your side. Whereas now, speaking out about Palestinian rights is sort of mainstream here in the UK and certainly amongst the trade union movement. And I think that that's a positive for us in terms of going forward and the work that we can do. But obviously we will continue to put pressure on our government around the HS2 contract. And, you know, the UN database has been received very positively here, you know, and as Carlo's right, it, in some ways, you know, we have to put pressure on people around the companies on there, but it's nobody's ever said that that is that's the only list you can use. Every company should be looked at, and where we find that they're not doing as we would want them to do, then we should challenge that. So, and we'll continue to do that.
I mean, we had the case of Veolia years back, and Veolia did lose a lot of particularly municipal contracts, I think, in the UK. Isn't that correct?
That is correct. And I mean, the other area that the trade unions particularly are doing a lot of work at the moment is around our pension funds and investments in local government pension schemes. So there's big, so obviously there was a pushback because there was a legal case around that. Anyway, we are now, that's been won, and we're now back fighting on those local government pension schemes and getting trade union members to put pressure on their local authorities to make sure that any companies that certainly that are on the UN list, but otherwise, you know, that we are concerned about, are not companies that those pension funds are investing in. So, that's another avenue as well that we are very heavily involved in. And again, that work that's been done is very useful in that.
I should just mention for people who perhaps haven't been involved in Palestinian solidarity for so long that Veolia is a French-based multinational which was previously involved in the JLR and sustained campaigning internationally in a number of different countries, particularly France and the UK, succeeded in persuading Veolia that their best interests were to withdraw from the JLR, and it's a campaign that gives us a great deal of hope with regard to our eventual success in persuading CAF of the same thing. Trina, if I could go back to you again. Question for you. Recently, it says over 9 municipalities in Norway, I don't exactly know how many, it says over 9 municipalities in Norway have committed to not buying products and services from the occupied territories. What opportunities do you think this opens specifically for the CAF campaign? And just to say, we're up to 100 people watching now. This debate is becoming very, very interesting. Keep your questions coming.
Well, I think, first of all, I think it's very important that municipalities actually states that they will not buy produce that is produced in that manner. But also I think trade unions play a great role, both unions within the public and private sector, because they can influence their own companies in the same direction as the trade union for municipality workers has done within these municipalities that states very clearly that they will not buy products produced by the settlements. There is generally good support for the Palestinian case in Norway in general, but of course people get frustrated because so little happens, and the struggle has lasted so long. But we also have to then see how can we also continue to be clear on our expectations, and the CAF situation is one such thing as in Norway. It was the rail workers trade union that made us aware of the situation and that there were Norwegian companies that were engaged in their procurements. So I think the trade unions, the Norwegian people's aides, various political parties, NGOs, and so on play an important role nationally to keep up the fight. But as I said, when we asked Norwegian trains to take CAF out of their equation, so to say, we were met by a one-sentence letter stating that there was no final conviction, no case rulings, so they could not take that into consideration, which I think is a clear example of how easy it is for companies to put the law or the paragraphs in our face without digging into the nitty-gritty of it. And unfortunately, I think there has to be quite a big organization to be able to dig into it, as we have done in our confederation. So we're not letting them get off the hook, but we do need this engagement from normal people in the streets. We do need the trade unions to be very clear on their expectations and so on. So I will just continue to do that. And then hopefully we are aiming to at least move some stones when it comes to the CAF situation and the Norwegian companies that that are involved with business with them. And then I think also, if I may, I think also there is a time where due diligence is expected, and at least also from younger generations, I mean, they expect it. So I think that's an angle that we can follow up to a greater extent than we have done so far, and at least that's what we have decided then within the confederation, to actually follow the money, and then in that way also keep the pressure up. Thank you.
Thanks, Trina. Coming back to you, Fayrouz, could you tell us a bit more about what the Israeli government's currently doing in occupied East Jerusalem, for example, in Sheikh Jarrah, where three Palestinian families are being forced to hand over their homes to settlers?
Yes, the wider context again. So yes, right now, imminent threats of eviction are now threatening Palestinian families, both in Sheikh Jarrah and in Silwan, where eviction orders have been given to families. And when we say eviction orders, I mean, it kind of gives the story legal legitimacy, but this is displacement. This is uprooting of Palestinians with the help of the Israeli court system. So occupation business continues as usual, no matter what is going on in the world. And I have already said this about the tram and the work on the infrastructure during the pandemic. For example, in 2020, there was a drastic rise in the number of demolished homes in Jerusalem as well. This is the Israeli colonizer using the cover that a pandemic and crisis, global crisis, gives them, so that they can go on with their crimes against Palestinians, hopefully in their view, unnoticed. And so we have witnessed an acceleration not only in infrastructure work, but in colonial activities in general in Jerusalem. And today there are families in Sheikh Jarrah that received expulsion orders saying that they have to leave at the beginning of May. And today there are campaigns, and people are campaigning, and the residents of Sheikh Jarrah are protesting those orders. It's a long story. We are talking about more than 20 families, 28 Palestinian refugee families who were supposed to receive homes as a deal from the Jordanian government in the 50s. The land was occupied in 67. The Jordanians never passed their ownership to the people. And then this was a very good opportunity for settler organizations to do what they do best, is to bring all of the budgets and money they have and all of the time and patience they have, because they can afford it, and drag Palestinian families to court in cases that could take years until they are eventually decided. So we are here talking about a case or cases that have been going on since the 70s. Again, claims to ownership over the land are accepted unconditionally by the Israeli court. And so based on this, the Israeli court is now expelling these families from their homes. The same is happening in Silwan. Silwan and Sheikh Jarrah are very strategically located communities. Silwan is just outside the old city to the south, and the Sheikh Jarrah is just outside the old city to the north. By taking over these two communities, by ethnically cleansing these two communities, Zionizing them, Israel creates a continuity of Israeli presence and control and occupation over the land. And so I think that there is also a need to pay attention to those campaigns that are happening. There is a lot being written and said about what's going on in Jerusalem, and this is an invitation to everyone watching us today also to look up that story and do whatever is possible in order to stop these evictions.
Thanks, Fayrouz. Turning back to you, Carlo, what exactly is the legal status of the UN guiding principles, and how can we force states to take international law and international treaties more seriously?
All right, well, this is the second part is a 1 million question, actually. As regards to the NGPs, well, their status is of a non-binding instrument of international law. So this is the first thing. But still, they're the most authoritative framework on the issue, which means that they must be regarded as an essential source for the interpretation and for a concrete definition of what businesses are expected to do, how they are expected to conduct their operations abroad. What is surely needed is a more binding instrument. There are discussions about a treaty, a binding treaty on business and human rights on a EU level, and as well on a UN level. At the EU level, on the other hand, there are discussions regarding a directive concerning business and human rights. So definitely is needed more specific and binding instruments. More in general, for rendering these international provisions effective, what is lacking is governmental willingness to do so, because without national enforcement of such instruments, then there are of course a few possibilities to obtain companies' respect of such standards of expected conduct. So as I said, in the field of procurement as well, we can argue, and it's true that authorities are lawfully entitled to interpret a ground of exclusion as I said, but what is needed, what would be definitely useful to have are more clear guidance and specific procurement notes, making clear that companies are expected to behave in a certain way, and if they don't, that there are certain consequences, in this case in the field of procurement, but there could be criminal consequences, civil liability. There are many possibilities for enforcing business compliance with human rights, but what is needed, and we have already a framework of standards of conduct, of expected behaviors by companies. What is needed is an implementation at the national level.
Thanks, Carlo. We're running out of time, so a last question for both Louise and Trina. Companies like CAF often use the workforce as a kind of a means of blackmail. They blackmail both the workers and the institutions with a threat of the workers losing their jobs. They say if CAF loses the JLR, then workers will lose their jobs at CAF factories. What arguments can we use to counter this message, do you think? First Louise and then you, Trina.
I mean, I think for me, we have to, as workers and as trade unionists, we have to stand in solidarity with the oppressed. That has to be a core of what we do. And it's quite clear that, you know, the Palestinian people have suffered mass oppression and we have a duty to stand by them. So that has to run sort of through what we do. What we have to say is that, I mean, I just, bosses will always use those sorts of arguments. We're not there to defend the bosses or to sort out their problems. We're there to stand in solidarity with people that are oppressed. But what we should be saying is that there are plenty of schemes that could be developed around things like, you know, it's certainly here in the UK, better green development and better green work. You know, there are plenty of jobs that can be done where we can employ workers. So we shouldn't be getting rid of workers, but we should be making sure that any work that we take on, any work that that they take on, is not violating any international laws. And I think it is important to keep going back to those international laws, because that is one thing that we have, you know, completely on our side. You know, the international law says that what is happening is wrong. So anybody that is complicit with that is breaking the law. And we shouldn't, you know, companies shouldn't be involved in that. They should be looking for projects that aren't doing those sorts of things and aren't complicit with, you know, with countries that are violating those international laws. And, you know, I think ultimately that has to be our argument. We can't be told that. And I think the final point I'll say really is, I think it goes back to what I said about educating the workforce. So the more we can make sure workers that work in those companies understand the reasons why we are doing what we're doing, why we're opposed to what is happening, the more they will support the action that we are taking. Otherwise, it just becomes workers pitted against workers, and we don't want that.
Well, I think once that we have to be aware of is that what you are putting your finger on will see even more pressure and even more of that due to the pandemic. I mean, the amount of loss of work around the world will give companies like CAF arguments in the direction that we have seen already when it comes to providing work for people. So we have to be aware that pressure will be even higher in the midst of the pandemic, because the loss of work around the world has been enormous. But then I'd like to pay the attention to two things that could give us new arguments and also put the fight on the agenda again. And that's on the 12th of April, ITUC will release a report on Palestinian workers' rights in Israel and in the settlements. The Confederation of Norway has co-sponsored that together with others. I think when that is released, it's a good opportunity to put that question on the agenda again, shed light on how the workers are being treated. So if they're good jobs or not is also essential, even though that does not defend in any way the human rights violations and the war crimes that the companies are representing. And then also, I mean, there's an ILO conference coming up this spring, and also then there will be released a yearly report on the situation of workers in the occupied Arab territories, and that's annexed to the Director General's report on the International Labour Conference. And I think that can also be used to shed light on the situation. That's in the that will be released in the end of May. But I do think generally, I mean, generally more solidarity. And also we need to be aware all the time and use every opportunity that we have. And now I've mentioned two of them to actually rise and have that debate on the situation, how it affects workers, what kind of jobs, and so on. I think the Palestinian people needs and deserves our support and solidarity, and as a trade unionist, they have it from us. Thank you.
Thanks. I just add a personal note to that, CAF is actually one of the companies that is least likely to be negatively affected by the pandemic, because with the European Union's massive recovery and resilience funding going particularly to things like shifts from private to zero emissions public transport, there are going to be, I mean, CAF's already been winning billion euro contracts in France. You talked about the contracts they've been winning in Norway. Their prospects for the future are very rosy, really. So their use of this argument is very, very, very bogus, in my opinion. Anyway, that's all we have time for. I just want to thank you all again. You've been a really excellent panel. It's been a really fascinating hour and a half, and I've got lots more questions I'd like to ask you all, but that'll have to wait for another day. There have been over 100 people following us, and for those people who've missed it, you can find a recording of this event on the Facebook channels of Eau de CAF, Palestinakomiteen Norway, and the Palestine Solidarity Campaign UK. So thanks to you all very much again, and we'll go out to a song that famous Basque singer Fermin Muguruza and Mr. Wilson made specifically for the campaign. Thanks again.
Thank you.
See you all. Gora Palestina.
عروقي في حبك مبتلى أنا لاجئ وصدق وأسلم أنا ابن صبرة وفي ملامحك نكبة أنا أنت وأنت في داخلي عودة
Stop that train as I'm telling you Stop that train Hechisaites Stop that train please stop it Stop that train Hechisaites
I'm telling you we don't want none of it
Stop that train, KG
Saites. Stop that train, Cafe Colangui, Ecarqui, Esandute.
Stop, stop,
Estira y Sango, Guerra en Complice.
So we don't want to train as I'm telling you.
Oh gosh, we don't want that train now.
Palestinar lurralde okupatuetan Eraikin nahi dute trenbide harresian Herrien eta langileen elkartasunak
Watch it.
Geldituko du Jerusalengo trenarina
Stop that train, Cavitilia
Stop that train Hechisaites
Stop that train
Stop that train Hechisaites
We don't wanna train out of here
Stop that train Hechisaites
Stop it, please stop it, baby
Cafe con langile Ekargi esan dute Estira izango Gerraren Komplize
Stop that train, I'm leaving
Palestine.
فاصل يا وطني محتلة وعروقي في حبك مبتلة. أنا لاجئ وسدرق الخيمة، أنا ابن صبرة وفي ملامحك نكبة، أنا أنت وأنت في داخلي عودة.